Okay. Good evening, everyone. Last time, we began to discuss Markov chains. Maybe we can review some conceptions before we go back to this example. So first, what is a Markov chain? A Markov chain is just a collection of random variables indexed by time. So we will be interested in how the Markov chain evolves, or so this collection of random variables evolve according to time. So then here, we're particularly interested in discrete time stochastic process, which is just a sequence of random variables with an index being the time. So then we discuss a notion called state space. So what is state space? The state space is just a set of all possible values that random variables in a stochastic process can take, right? So just set of all possible values. And what is a Markov chain? So Markov chain, so first, the Markov chain refers to discrete time stochastic process. And the definition is like this. So if we use this sequence x0, x1 for this Markov chain, then it must satisfy this condition. So what is this condition? On the right-hand side, it is a conditional probability, and on the right-hand side, it's also a conditional probability. So let's check this conditional probability. To better understand this, maybe we can think of the current time as n. Time n refers now, right? So then on the left-hand side, it is the conditional probability that we're given the entire history. We know the state at time 0, at time 1, up to now. Now means time n, right? So we wish to know what is the probability that in the next step, we will be in state j, right? Based on the entire history, we wish to predict what will happen next time. So this is on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, it is simply the conditional probability that next time we're in state j, given that now we're in state in, right? So the right-hand side is that we only, based on our current state, we predict what will happen next step, right? Because these two conditional probabilities are equal, it means that so for a Markov chain, so even if you know the entire history up to now, so it will help you to know more about what will happen in the future beyond what you are knowing the current step, right? So in other words, for a stochastic process to be a Markov chain means that if you know the current state, then what happened in the past? So here, past means time 0 up to time n minus 1. What happened in the past becomes independent to what will happen in the future. So which means that you know your current step is sufficient for you to determine what will happen in the future. So this is if a stochastic process satisfies this property, so then it is called a Markov chain. Why we're interested in a Markov chain? Because with such a nice property, we can analyze a Markov chain step by step, right? So for example, if we begin with whatever state, after amount of time, we move to a certain state, and we wish to know what will happen in the future. Because this stochastic process is a Markov chain, as long as you know the current state, what happened in the past becomes independent of the future. So which means that you don't have to track the entire history, so which makes the analysis very simple. In this case, you don't care how did you reach the current state. As long as you know that I'm here now, it's sufficient for you to predict what will happen in the future. In this way, actually, you can analyze a Markov chain just step by step. From time zero to time one, then follow whatever distribution, then you can forget about time zero. From time one, you can predict what will happen at time two, and so on, right? So, so that's why we are so interested in this Markov chain. And what is a time homogeneous Markov chain? So which means that the transition probability does not change with time. So what is a transition probability? So for example, so this conditional probability is the transition probability from I to J at time n, right? If this transition probability does not depend on time, which means that for whatever n, it should be the same. So in this case, for our convenience, we just use this Pij to denote the transition probability from I to J by one step, right? And as long as you know the transition probabilities of the Markov chain, as long as you know the initial state, actually, is sufficient for us to describe the behavior of this Markov chain. So this is just several important notions. And last time, we discussed such an example. So in this example, so we consider a store that sells laptop computers, right? And we assume that the weekly demands are IID following so this distribution. The demand could be zero up to four computers, and this is the distribution, right? So we use this Dn for the demand of week n. And for this little store, it has an integer policy. So the policy is like this. If at the end of each week, if the inventory is less than or equal to 1, then the store orders more to bring the inventory back to 4 at the beginning of next week. So, and the question is, suppose that at the beginning, so the store has 4 computers. We wish to know the expected value of the inventory level at at the beginning of week 10, right? So keep in mind the ordering policy is like this. As long as you have less than 2, less than or equal to 1 at the beginning of a week, then at the beginning of next week, you must have 4. And just for this example, we discussed the transition probability for that, right? So based on this policy, we can calculate the transition probabilities. So for example, this P22 would be the transition probability from 2 to 2, which means that at the beginning of this week, I have 2 computers. What is the probability that at the beginning of next week, I still have 2, right? So this one, for example, this one, P43, means that at the beginning of this week, I have 4. What is the probability that at the beginning of next week, I have 3, and so on. So it would be more convenient for us to organize all those transition probabilities into a matrix, so which is called a transition matrix, right? So, for example, in this example, the transition matrix looks like that. So each row corresponds to a state, and each column corresponds to a state too, right? So, for example, if we check this entry, this 0.3 should be the transition probability from state 4 to state 3, right? So you must be very clear about the meaning of this transition matrix. And also, so this is the general form of a transition matrix of an arbitrary Markov chain. And if this Markov chain has n states, then the ijth entry is just the transition probability from state I to state j, and so on. And also, so we can also use transition diagram to represent the dynamics of a Markov chain. And so in those circles, so each circle stands for a state, and we use arrows with a number between 0 and 1 to denote the transition and the corresponding transition probabilities, right? So so this is so what we discussed last time, right? So we have this laptop example, and we have derived all the transition probabilities. So when we talk about transition probabilities, it is just a one-step transition probability from state I to state J by one step, right? So then let's consider the next question. So in this example, what is the distribution of X2, right? So we know the transition probabilities, and we know the initially we have four computers at hand. Then what is the what is the distribution of X2, so which is the image level at the beginning of the second week. So that's we'll check that, how to calculate how to calculate the distribution of X2. So again, here we wish to know the distribution of X2. And we know that the state space is like this. It has only three, so for this Markov chain, it has only three states. Because of the ordering policy at the beginning of each week, we can have either two or three or four states, right? And so because so X2 can only take those three possible values, so essentially, if we wish to know the distribution of X2, actually, we need to know what is the probability that, so given the initial image level is 4, what is the probability that X takes 2, X takes 3, and X takes 4, right? As long as we know these three probabilities, then so we know the distribution, because it can only take those three values. How to calculate this distribution? And actually, maybe we just consider, because we need to calculate those three probabilities, maybe just let's just consider one by one. So for example, what is this probability? So given that we begin with four computers, what is the probability that in 2 weeks we will have two, right? So to calculate this probability, maybe we can think of that a little bit. So for example, I can draw a picture like this to help you to better understand this conditional probability. So we know that for this Markov chain, it has only three states. It could be two, could be three, it could be four, right? And for and each time, it may only take those three values. So for example, if we consider X0 means the initial image level, right? We know that it's it must be four. It's fixed here. Right? But as we argued, if we think of X1, it could take any value, so among 2, 3, and 4. And for X2, also could be 2, 3 or 4. So we wish to know this probability. We begin with 4. What is the probability that in 2 steps will be in 2, right? So because it's in 2 steps, actually, we can think in that way. So in 2 steps, which means that after 1 step, we can be in any of the 3 steps, right? So for example, it's possible for us to first make transition from 4 to 2 by 1 step, from x0 to x1, from 4 to 2, and then from 2 to 2. So this is a one path to x2. It is also possible that we make transition from 4 to 3 in 1 step, and then from 3 to 2. Also, so we can make transition from 4 to 4 and 4 to 2. So here, you see that, so if we wish to know this conditional probability, so we have 3 ways to reach 2 from 4 in 2 steps, right? So either this way, or this way, or this way. And actually, what does this mean? It means that this conditional probability can be divided into the sum of 3 conditional probabilities, right? So the first one is we begin from 4, and by 1 step we will reach 2, and then 2. So this conditional probability corresponds to this path, right? Also, it's possible that we make transition from 4 to 3 and 3 to 2. That is this path. Or 4 to 4, 4 to 2. So this path. Right? So, that's great. So which means that if we wish to know this conditional probability, then we can just need to calculate. So this one, this one, and this one. Now, maybe let's consider the first one. Let's first analyze what is this probability, conditional probability. So this conditional probability is 4 to 2 and 2 to 2, right? Again, so which is the first path. How to calculate so this conditional probability? So we just need to use the definition of conditional probability, right? It's a So this guy, actually, because it's a conditional probability, it is simply equal to the intersection over the condition, right? So intersection, what is the intersection? So again, this comma means intersection. So intersection of this one and this one. So the numerator should look like this. The numerator is probability that x0, 4, x1, 2, and x2, 2, right? Divided by the condition. Condition is this guy. So this is just, so far, we just, so this step, we just need the definition of conditional probability. So then, how can we proceed? So then the trick is for the numerator. So this numerator can be written as this one. So we use the law of total probability. So then this probability of intersection can be written as a conditional probability times the condition, probability of the condition, right? But here we use the condition like this. We take this x0 and x1 as the condition. So the condition is here. This conditional probability times so the probability of the condition. So this one is so this numerator, right? But then you ask me the question, so why bother to do this? Because we're handling a Markov chain, right? So, and then this conditional probability actually looks nice. It's the conditional probability, so given the entire history, and we know that for, because this X is a Markov chain, we don't need the entire history, As long as we know the current state, it's enough, right? So that is to say, actually, this probability is equal to this one, right? So this is the key step. So from the probability in this red circle, we have the probability in this red circle. So this x0 is equal to 4. It's independent of what will happen in the future. So this one is equal to this one. And then, so the remaining part is this probability divided by this one, right? So what is that? So it is another conditional probability given by this. So you see in this a green circle, it is equal to this conditional probability. And then, what is this? So the conditional probability in this red circle actually is just a P22, conditional probability from 2 to 2, right? So it's here. In this green circle, it's the transition probability from 4 to 2. So that is here. So you see that if we wish to know this conditional probability, so given that we're beginning from 4, what is the probability that? So we need to, we can go to 2 by one step and then go to 2 by one step. It is simply equal to P42 times P22. Right? So this is just a, this is, these are my derivation, but actually, I think that based on the property of Markov chains, it is very easy to understand that, right? So, how to understand this? We're interested in this conditional probability, right? We know that at the beginning, we are from state 4. So, to study this conditional probability, maybe we can first think, what is the probability from 4 to 2 by one step? Of course, it is just so this conditional probability, right? And then we know that at this state, because we have moved for the very first step, at this state, we are in state 2 now. Right? At time 1, we're in state 2. Because you're already in state 2, how did you reach there? It does not matter, right? It will be independent of the future. So then if you wish to know what is the probability that, given this, what is the probability that you will be in state 2 at time 2, then it must be that it must be the probability that transition probability from 2 to 2, right? Why is so? Again, as I said, after you move, after you make the first transition, now you're at time 1. How did you reach your current state? Will become independent of the future. If you wish to know what is the probability that I move from 2 to 2 by one step, then you just times the transition probability that P22, right? So that's why this probability must look like this. So you see, that is this probability. But our purpose is to calculate this one, right? And we know that, so this one consists of three probabilities. So this one, and this one. So they correspond to three paths. So we just discussed the first paths. Again, the first path is we move from 4 to 2 by one step, and then from 2 to 2 by one step. As we discussed just now, so you see that from this state to here, so it happens with probability P42. And then from here to here, it happens with probability P22. Right? So again, so that's the idea for this, how to analyze the very first pass. Then, as long as you understand what happened in the first pass, then we can discuss the second pass, the third pass, in a similar way, right? The second pass is just we make transition from four to three by one step, and then from three to two. Then you see that must be equal to this P43 times P32. And for the third pass, we make transition from four to four by one step, and then from four to two. The corresponding probability must be equal to P44 times P42, right? So then you see, so what is this probability? What is the probability that we go, given that we're at four at the beginning, then what is the probability that we'll be in two by two steps? By two steps, as we discussed, we have three paths, right? So the corresponding probabilities are, so this guy, and this guy. And then we just add them up together. Then we have this probability, conditional probability. So this is just what we have just now, right? So this guy, the probability x2 is equal to 2, given that x0 is 4, is equal to this, right? So this expression. So then maybe we can track. So what are those transition probabilities in the transition matrix, right? So let's review what is this transition. We know that the transition matrix looks like that, right? Again, each row corresponds to a state, each column corresponds to a state, right? So for example, the last row corresponds to state 4, and the first column corresponds to state 2, right? You need to keep it in mind. Here, actually, let's check. So this, so the probability we just derived. So this is the probability you make transition from 4 to 2 in two steps, right? And it's equal to P42 times P22. Where is P42? P42 should be this guy, right? 0.2. It's transition probability from state 4 to state 2. So it should be in the row corresponds to state 4, and in the column corresponds to state 2. So it must be this guy, right? So P42 times P22. P22 is this guy, 0.3. So this one times this one, and the plus P43 times P32. P43 is this guy. P32 is this guy. Plus P44 times P42. P42 is this 0.5, and P42 is this 0.2, right? So you see, here, actually, from this expression, you can see that this two-step transition probability from 4 to 2 in two steps, actually, it corresponds to the product of this row and this column, right? So if you know the matrix multiplication, So what is the product of this row and this column? It just so this guy times this guy plus this guy times this guy plus this guy times this guy, right? So see here, as you wish to know, so what is the two-step transition probability from 4 to 2? You use the row corresponds to state 4, so which is this blue row, right, times the column of state 2, so which is this red column. So blue row times red column, you have the transition, two-step transition probability from 4 to 2, right? So it looks very nice, right? So then, if you understand this, so then maybe it's much simpler for you to calculate. So the two-step transition probability from 4 to 3. At the beginning, you have 4. What is the probability that in 2 weeks you have 3? So how to calculate that? So it's very similar to this calculation. Because if you wish to know this, it should just be the row of state 4 times the column of state 3, right? So this row times this column, then you should have the two-step transition probability from 4 to 3, right? And then what is the two-step transition probability from 4 to 4? Similar. So you just need to use this row times the row of state 4 times the column of state 4. So just in a similar way. Any questions? So is there anything not clear in the previous steps? So then you see that if you have a transition matrix, and by using matrix metaglutation, you can derive two-step transition probabilities, right? At least we have discussed from state 4, so with what probability, so you can reach state 2, 3, 4 in 2 steps, right? It just corresponds to the row of state 4 times corresponding columns of those states. So then maybe we can think of the question like this. So how if we start with other states, say state 2, state 3, what will be the transition? What would be the two-step transition probabilities, right? So, for example, if we use this EIJ2, so I put this 2, subscript 2 in a parentheses to denote the two-step transition probability from I to J, so which is defined like this. So, at the beginning, you have state I, and after 2 steps, you'll be in state J. So what will be that probability? So for such two-step transition probabilities, if we organize them together, so in a way of we create the one-step transition matrix, then we can have this two-step transition matrix, right? So for example, in this example, we just use, so for example, this guy is the probability when we transition from 4 to 2 by 2 steps, right? And based on what we discussed just now, actually, we already know the last row of this two-step transition matrix of this example, of this laptop example, right? So it turns out to be, so this row times this column, then we have this number. And this row times, so this column, we have this number, 0.24. And this row times this column, we have this number, right? So then the question is, if we wish to know all of this two-step transition matrix, how can we have it? How can we get it, right? And actually, based on what we discussed just now, so for the last row, if we just use so this row times so this matrix, and actually, if we wish to know what is the first row, what is the second row, we just need to use the first row times this matrix, the second row times the matrix, right? So what does it mean? Actually, it means that two-step transition matrix is just the one-step matrix times the one-step matrix. In other words, if this P is the one-step transition matrix, then this P squared, P times P, is just the two-step transition matrix. But you need to know, so this is a matrix multiplication. It's not, so this guy times this guy, this guy times this guy, this guy times this guy. It is not entry-wise multiplication. It's a matrix multiplication, right? So, this entry? This entry should be the first row times the first column. So, and so on. If you cannot remember how to do matrix multiplication, I think you have to go back to check your linear algebra textbook, right? So, this is how to derive the two-step transition matrix. If we know the two-step transition matrix, actually, we can, from an arbitrary state, to derive the distribution in two steps, right? So that'd be great. So then, maybe we can think of, we know how to do from step one, from step zero, from time zero to time one. And then we just discussed how we can analyze from step one to step two, right? So then I think it's time to generalize this idea. So what would be the k-step transition matrix? So before I discuss this result, maybe I just gave you the definition of k-step transition matrix. So this is very similar to the two-step transition matrix. Suppose that we have a time homogeneous Markov chain that has m states, and you just call them state 1 up to state m, right? So then we use this Pijk, this guy, to denote the transition probability from state I to state j by k steps, right? So if we put it in the fth row and jth column, fth row, jth column, so we put the transition, k-step transition probability from I to j, so such a matrix is called k-step transition matrix. So how can we get this k-step transition matrix? The idea, actually, if we just follow the idea of how do we get the two-step transition matrix, I think probably you can imagine what we will have, right? So if we just put it in the simplest way, actually it is just this blue formula. So if this P It's the one-step transition matrix. So in this matrix, we have all one-step transition probabilities. So what is the k-step transition matrix? It is simply equal to p to the power k. So you have one-step transition matrix, and you multiply it to itself k times. You have this k-step transition matrix. And this result, so it's referred to the Chapman-Komolov equations. So this Chapman-Komolov equations describe the transition behavior of the Markov chain. So it gives you, as long as you know the one-step transition probabilities, it helps you to calculate arbitrary step transition probabilities. It has different forms. Actually, the most common form looks like that. Let's check that. So here again, so we know that we use this PIJK. So if we put K into a pair of parentheses, so this one stands for the k step transition probability from I to J, right? And this Chapman-Komolov equation says that so the k plus L step transition probability from I to J can be calculated in this way. It is the summation for all states. So this capital S is the state space, right? So this lowercase s is just an arbitrary state in the state space. So it's just the sum of all p I s by k steps, transition probability from I to s by k steps, times transition probability from s to j by l steps. So this k plus l step transition probability is equal, can be calculated in this way. So this result is called Chapman-Komolov equations. So how do I understand this? And actually, it's also pretty straightforward. On the left-hand side, so we know that it's a transition probability from I to J by K plus L steps, right? K plus L steps. So then maybe you can think of the question like this. So we wish to know the transition probability from I to J by K plus L steps. Then where am I in K steps? So we begin from state I. We wish to know that what is the probability that we reach J in K plus L steps. So where am I in K steps, right? Actually, bound for K steps, you could be in any state. So you could be in an arbitrary state, lowercase s, right? So from I to s by K steps, the probability would be, so this guy. This is the k-step transition probability from I to S. So it says that you begin from I. You just move. So after k-steps, you should be in a state. Maybe we just call this state S, lowercase s, right? So keep in mind that, so this is a Markov chain. So then, if you wish to predict what will happen in the future, how did you arrive here would not matter. It would be independent of the future, right? So, but your purpose is to calculate from I to J by K plus L steps. Now you're in the state S. If you wish to reach state J in L steps, the probability must be so this one, right? So this is the transition probability from S to J by L steps. So again, why is so? Because it's a Markov chain. As long as you're in S, then the probability you will reach J in L steps must be this one, right? So then you see that, so this is just a, as we discussed, here. So that one stands for one pass, right? Just like a pass like that. But here, so this S is just an intermediate state, and A can be any one. So this is so this product is just the probability of one pass. And we this S could be any state, so we need to add all those paths together for all possible states, lowercase s. But then, so that is this Chapman-Kolmogorov equations. So, based on my description, you can see that, so this Chapman-Kolmogorov equations is just a somewhat a generalized version of the picture I got here, right? So we just consider different paths. How can we go from one state to another state? So how to calculate the corresponding probability of each pass? So that's that is how to understand this Chapman-Kolmogorov equations. So this one, you see that this one is given by the form of a summation, and as we discussed the year, so such summation actually corresponds to a row of the matrix of a k-step transition matrix times a column of L-step transition matrix, right? So as a result, as we discussed previously, so such a form is equivalent to transition. Equivalent to, so such a result. If we use this P K plus L for the K plus L step transition matrix, so this result, this summation is equivalent to say K plus L transition matrix is equal to the K step transition matrix times the L step transition matrix, right? And then, so because we know that if the one-step transition matrix, that's just a P, right? You know, this K and L are arbitrary positive integers. Then from here, as we discussed just now, if we take K and L to be 1 and 1, then you see the two-step transition matrix must be P squared, P times P. And then what will be the three-step transition matrix? So if K is 2, L is 1, then the three-step transition matrix must be equal to P squared times P, which is PQ, and so on, right? And then by induction, we can argue that this K-step transition matrix must be equal to P to the power K. So that's how we reach from the original version of this Chapman-Kolmogorov equations to here, to this Bloom formula. So that is the explanation of this Chapman-Kolmogorov equations. And actually, we know that Kolmogorov is a Russian mathematician, and so this Chapman actually he's not a mathematician. He was a British geologist. Geologist means he study rocks, say how the earth or the mountains evolve for a long period of time. And he modeled his study using Markov chain. So that's why he derived equations like this to describe the evolution of rocks. So that's why. So his name is also here. So Komarov and Chapman, they derived these equations independently. So both of their names are there. So this is the the main theorem for the Markov chain. And this one, for this expression, actually it can also be written in this way. So we know that we use this PIJK, so we put K in pair of parentheses for the k-step transition probability from I to J, right? So which is equal to this and equal to this. And this result, actually, it shows that it is equal to the ijth entry of p to the power k. It may also be written in this way, right? From now on, so we will, because this notation is simpler, so we will just write it in this way. But you need to understand, so if we write in this way, it means the ijth entry of p to the power k, right? So let me explain a bit more. So we need to be a bit careful about the notation. So as I explained, so previously we used this to denote the k-step transition probability from state I to state J, right? The definition is like this. And by the Chapman-Komarov equations, we know that, so this one is simply equal to the ijth entry. What does ijth entry mean? In the matrix, it's in the ith row and the jth column. So it's an ijth entry of the matrix P to the power k. So here, this P to the power k is a matrix. It's the ijth entry of this matrix, right? So this matrix is the kth power of the one-step transition matrix P. So why I need to emphasize that? Because you need to understand this notation is not the same as this one. Because Pij is one entry of the transition matrix. It's a one-step transition probability. It is not the kth power of a one-step transition probability. Okay? Because so this notation, I think it could be confusing. So this one is not this one. Is the entry of this matrix. It is not the kth power of the one-step transition probability, right? So please keep in mind, because otherwise, for our later discussion, it could be confused. Then maybe let's check an example. So in this laptop example, what will be the probability like this? You begin with four computers. Then after 1 week, you have two. In week three, at the beginning of week three, you have three. And at the beginning of week six, you have two. So how to calculate such a probability? Actually, of course, you can use the definition of conditional probability, and then use Markov properties and so on. But actually, as long as you understand what we have discussed, I think it would be pretty simple to write down the expression like this, right? So let me explain. So why is this expression make sense. So we wish to know such a probability, right? So first, you need to start from state 4. From state 4, so first you need to reach state 2 in one step, right? From 4 to 2 in one step, the corresponding transition probability would be P42, right? After making this transition, now the time is 1 and you are in state 2, right? So the next state would be state 3 in 2 steps. Now you are in 2, right? So what is the probability you make transition from 2 to 3 in 2 steps? Why it is in 2 steps? Because the current time is 1. Right? You wish to know what will happen at time 3. So that transition probability should be from 2 to 3 by 2 steps. So that probability should be this one. So this is the transition probability from 2 to 3 by 2 steps. And it is, so this entry in the 2-step transition matrix. The 2-step transition matrix is just a P squared. Right? So now, after you making so this transition, the current time will be 3, right? Now you're in state 3. The next transition you need to make is from 3 to 2 in 3 steps, right? From 3 to 2 in 3 steps. What is that? It's just from 3 to 2 in 3 steps. So that is how to calculate this transition probability. And if you wish to derive all of this, the steps are here. If you wish to have better understanding, maybe you can check this. And you see that using Markov property, so you can simplify certain conditions. But in the end, it must have this, right? So again, why we can have this? As I said, because it is a Markov chain. So first, you make transition from 4 to 2. And then, as long as you're now in state 2, how did you arrive at this state will not matter to the future. So to decide the transition in the future, you just based on your current state. You don't care about the history, right? So this is a very simple example. Questions? So, if no questions, I think you can see that we're ready to answer the question: what is the expected value of x10? Right? Because now we are able to derive the distribution of x10. So why is so? Because we can calculate the 10-step transition matrix. So what is the 10-step transition matrix? It is simply the 1-step transition matrix to the power 10. Right? So the 1-step transition matrix is here, looks like that. It's a 3x3 matrix. However, even if this matrix is simple, but to find out the 10th power of that may not be easy if you wish to do that manually, right? So then how can we get this p to the power 10? So maybe you can use, say, like that, right? Let's see. Let me get this. So the transition matrix looks like that. .3, 0.7. That's the first row. saturation low is 0.3, 0.3, 0.4. Third row is 0.2, 0.3, 0.5. So it looks like that. So that is the, I'm not sure if you can see it. So that's the so that is the matrix P. Let's see, what is the P to the power of 10? This looks like that. Which is here, right? So P to the power 10. So we know that at the beginning we have four computers. So then what is the distribution of X10? So we know that X10 could be 2, could be 3, could be 4. And we just need to find out the corresponding probabilities. So the transition probability from 4 to 2 in 10 steps would be, so this number, right? From 4 to 3 in 10 steps would be this one. And this one's, so this one is from 4 to 4 by 10 steps and so on, right? So as long as we have those three probabilities, and then what is the expected value of X10? Just 2 times the probability that it takes 2, 3 times the probability it takes 3, 4 times the probability it takes 4. Right? So then it's equal to, so this number, 3.28 something. So this is how can we get this? But so you see that it's nice that we just, we can, because of this, Chapman-Cormoran equations, we can calculate the arbitrary number, the transition probabilities by arbitrary number of steps, right? So that's what we have. So maybe we can modify this problem a little bit. Suppose that at the beginning of V0, the number of computers we have is unknown. Maybe it's a random variable. So it could be 4, it could be 2, it could be 3, right? So for example, suppose that we follow the distribution like this, right? So in this way, we find out the distribution of X3, the number of computers at the beginning of V3. So let's think of so this question. How can we derive the solution for that? So now we have. Now, we assume that at the beginning, the number of computers is a random variable, right? So it could be 2 or 3 or 4. So we wish to know the distribution of X3. So again, we know that the state space is just 2, 3, or 4. So essentially, so the distribution of X3 means what is the probability that it takes 2, takes 3, and takes 4, and so on, right? So, how can I calculate that? So, for example, let's think of what is the probability that X3 takes 2. What is this? So, for this, for this to happen, and actually let me consider three different cases corresponding to different initial memory travel. Because at the beginning, it could be we may have two computers, we may have three computers, we may have four computers, right? So you see that this conditional probability, this probability can be written into three cases. It's equal to those three, the sum of those three probabilities. And for each one, we may use the law of total probability. It can be written as a conditional probability times the probability of condition. For example, the first one is simply a conditional probability that we may transition from 2 to 2 by 3 steps times the probability that initially we have 2. Right? And for the second one, it's the probability that initially we have 3 times the probability that we have 3 from 3 to 2 by 3 steps, right, and so on. The third one is just when we transition from 4 to 2 means 3 steps times the probability that at the beginning we have 4. In this way, if it's written in this way, actually you can see, so this, it is equal to the initial distribution. So it's just 0.5, 0.2, 0.3 times the corresponding transition probabilities, and we add them up together, right? So based on this discussion, it is equal to that. Or it's just like that. So and if we just for this initial distribution, if we use this mu zero to denote this distribution as a row vector, this mu zero is the initial distribution of the unit travel. So if it's denoted by this row vector, and based on our discussion like that, you can see that so the probability that x3 takes 2 is simply equal to so this number times from 2 to 2 by 3 steps. And this number from 3 to 2 by 3 steps, and so on, right? It can be written sort of in this way. So, if, so that's, essentially, that's the initial distribution as the row vector times the column of the three-step transition probability. Transition matrix. So if you check that, because here it is a so this probability is from 2 to 2 by 3 steps, is 3 to 2 by 3 steps, 4 to 2 by 3 steps. It is simply so the first row of the 3-step transition probabilities, because that's all the any states may transition to state 2 in 3 steps, right? So that is this row. It has this value. If we calculate that, so if we calculate that, so this matrix, it has this value. And so these three values are here. And if this mu 2, mu 3, mu 4 is written as the row vector here, essentially, so this probability, the probability that x3 takes 2 is simply so this row vector times the column corresponds to state 2 in the 3-step transition matrix. Right? So what we discussed just now is just to help you understand that So this, the probability that x3 takes 2 is equal to initial distribution times the column corresponds to state 2 in the three-step transition matrix, right? So this row times this column. So based on this discussion, so if I ask you a question, so what is the probability that x3 takes 3? So it should be, so this initial distribution times, so the second column, because the second column corresponds to state 3, right?
And if the initial distribution times the third column, because the third column corresponds to state 4, then you will have the probability that x3 takes 4. So that is so this result. And actually, so it could be more convenient for us to use so this notation, say mu 3, so writing this way, to denote the distribution of x3, so as a row vector. So because here, in this example, the state space has only three states, so each row vector, just three-dimensional, corresponds to so state 2, state 3, and state 4, respectively, right? And then, if we wish to know the distribution of x3, based on what we discussed just now, it is simply equal to the initial distribution times the three-step transition matrix, right? So that is what we discussed just now. And this result can be generalized. So suppose that we have a time homogeneous Markov chain that has m states, right? If we use this uk as an m-dimensional row vector, each entry corresponds to the probability that at time k is in a certain state. Right? So, for example, the first entry is the probability that, so this Markov chain is in state 1 at time k, and so on, right? And then, how can we get this distribution at k, at time k? It is simply equal to the initial distribution times the k-step transition matrix. So, mu 0 times pk. So, for example, in this example, suppose that the initial distribution looks like that, and then how can we find the distribution of x10? So, according to this result, if the initial distribution looks like that, and we also know that P10 is equal to this matrix, so this guy times, so this matrix, then we know the distribution of x10, right? So let's just follow this result. Questions? So if there are no questions, maybe we can have a 2-minute break. So let's move on. So actually, I think some of you may have noticed that when we get this 10-step transition matrix, you can see that so this guy, so the first column, all the entries in the first column looks the same, right? The second column looks the same, third column looks the same. So in other words, if we check each row, actually all rows are the same. All rows look the same. All rows has the first row, the second row, the third row. So all same rows, right? So this one looks a bit confusing. So why does that happen? Right? Maybe we can check the calculation again. So this is what do we have just now, right? It's p to the power 3. What is p? P is here. So definitely p, so the end, so the different entries in this matrix P have different values, right? But when we calculate p to the power 10, it seems that so in each row all the entries have the same value. So maybe we don't check 10. Maybe we check smaller than 1. We just calculate p to the power 3. So you see that p looks like that. But p to the power 3, so if we check each row, the entries are different. The values of them are pretty close, right? So we see so in the first row, the verb, so at least the first two digits are all the same. For the second row, the third row, so the numbers are pretty similar. So then it seems that because of this observation, it seems that so probably if a p to the power 10, so for each row we have the same entries, probably just because of we don't have sufficient digits. If we have longer digits, then it would be different. So maybe we can check if p to the power 10, if we check if we have more digits, let's check if they're still the same. So this is a command called format long. Format long means that we will keep more digits for the numerical results. So now let's see what is p to the power 10. You see now, we have more digits for p to the power 10. But if you can see it clearly, you can see at least the first 7 digits are all the same. But after the first 7 digits, it looks a bit different. For the second row, it's very similar. The first 7 digits are the same, but other digits could be different. So see here, this 10-step transition matrix, for each row, they do not have exactly the same entries. But those entries are very, very, very close. So down the, I think you can imagine, if we have two probabilities that they have their first 7 digits are all the same, then for almost all practical cases, we can simply take them as two equal numbers, right? But why does this can happen? So then, maybe let's accept the fact that p to the power 10, roughly speaking, each row will have same entries, right? And then given this, let's think of how to interpret this 10-step transition matrix. Maybe let's observe the first row, right? The first row corresponds to transition probabilities from whatever state to state 2 by 10 steps, right? So for example, the first one is the 10-step transition probability from 2 to 2, the second one from 3 to 2, and so on. But because those probabilities are almost the same, maybe from now on I just said, I will just say they're the same for my convenience. Because all those numbers are the same, what does it mean? It means that no matter what is your initial state is, no matter it's 2 or 3 or 4, after 10 steps, the probability that you're in state 2 will be this number, the same number. So no matter where you come from, after 10 steps, the probability that you're in state 2 will be this probability, 0.2473. The probability you will be in state 3 will be 0.2258. The probability you're in state 4 will be 2.5269, right? So it means that after 10 steps, whether you remember where is your initial state, it does not matter, right? So the probability that you're in state 2 will be this number. State 3 will be this number. State 4 will be this number. But then let's come back to this this example. What does it mean? So here, we wish to find out the distribution of x10. So as we discussed before the break, we use this mu 10 to denote the distribution of x10. As we discussed, it could be in state 2, state 3, and state 4. And also, as we discussed, because this 10-step transition matrix has such a structure, so each column have all identical entries. So then, no matter what is your initial distribution, what is your initial state, then because after 10 steps, your probability in each state must be so those numbers. So then, we must have the result that the distribution of x10 actually is just an arbitrary row of this 10-step transition matrix. Why arbitrary row? Because all rows are the same, right? Because where you're from would not matter in 10 steps. So that's what we discussed just now. And actually, it can also be seen from the direct calculation, right? So if we wish to calculate the distribution by using this result, this proposition. So we just discussed how can we find out the distribution at time t. So at time t, you just use the initial distribution as a row vector times the k stack transition matrix, right? So your initial distribution is given by this row vector. So this is the 10-step transition matrix, right? You need to use this vector times this matrix. But keep in mind, this vector is for a distribution. As a result, so the sum of this vector, of this row vector, must be equal to 1, right? It is equal to 1. And so this guy times the first row will get the first entry, times the second row, again the second entry, right? And because each row has the same entries, so this entry actually will serve as a common factor. You can take it out. You take it out, so if this initial distribution times the first row, what will you have? It's just the common number times the sum of this vector. The sum of this vector is 1, right? So then you see, if this vector times the first row, you just get the common number of this first row
times the second row, get the common number of the second row, and so on. Right? Because all rows are the same. And as a result, as long as so this guy is a distribution, then in the end, you must have an arbitrary row, any row of this matrix. Right? So it's somewhat amazing because it seems that actually, at least for this example, so after amount of time, then the distribution that you're in the arbitrary state will keep the same. The probability that you're in state 2 will be that number, in state 3 will be that number, and so on. Where are you from? Well, where is your initial state? It will become irrelevant, right? So then, if I ask you the question, can we know the distribution of X10 if you even don't know the initial distribution, or you don't know the initial image level, then, of course, it's okay, because distribution must look like that, right? So this is actually an amazing observation. So here, so as I just explained, so for this 10-step position matrix, each column has identical entries. And so what does it mean? It means that the distribution of X10 actually becomes independent of the initial distribution. Independent means, so no matter what is your initial distribution, no matter what is your initial image level, then after 10 steps, so your distribution will always be like this, a row of this matrix, right? And as I explained just now, so if we check more digits of those numbers, and you will see that actually the entries in the same row are not exactly the same, but the difference is very, very small. And in this example, after 10 times of transitions, so then at least we have the first 7 digits all the same. And it could be taken extremely close to each other in most practical applications, right? And also, so as I explained, so it seems that after a number of transitions, the distribution of the state becomes the initial distribution, right? So because each column has the same entries. And we may check a bit more of this. So this is p to the power 10. So let's check, what is p to the power 11? P to the power 11, you see, at least the first, so this is p to the power 10. This is p to the power 11. You see, so those two matrices are almost the same, right? Say p to the power of, still almost the same, right? And this is not difficult to understand why it must be the same, because as long as after amount of time, so the k-step transition matrix becomes something like this. Something like this means entries in each row become nearly the same. As long as we have this, then, for example, let's given that p to the power 10 is like this, so what is p to the power 11? P to the power 11 should be p times p to the power 10, right? P
times t to the power 10. So then, so which means that each row of p times the column of p to the power 10, right? So p, each row of p needs to times this one, this one, and this one. And what is p? P is a transition matrix, right? So the row sum of a transition matrix is equal to 1, right? So then the case is exactly like what we discussed here. If you use a row, so with sum 1 to times a matrix, and this matrix have all identical entries in each column, then the result must be the a row of this entry, right? So here, you can see that p times p to the power 10 must be equal to p to the power 10. If you use p, so p to the power 11 should be the same as p to the power 10. And we can argue in this way, p to the power 12, p to the power 13. So in this way, you can see that as k goes large, the k stack transition matrix will keep the same. It will no longer change, right? So that's an amazing result. But also, as a result, if we think of what is the distribution of X10, X11, and so on, so they will also be equal to so this the same row, right? Because it's equal to initial distribution times such a matrix, no matter what your initial distribution is, then so this distribution must just be a row of this matrix, right? So from here, actually, we can see that, so for this Markov chain, for the Markov chain of our laptop example, so it appears something like this. After amount of time, the distribution of the Markov chain becomes independent of initial distribution. No matter where is you're from, no matter what is the initial distribution, after amount of time, the probability that you are in a certain state will be given by this matrix, right? So that's the first observation. And the second observation is that after amount of transition, distribution of the Markov chain no longer change with time. So why is so? Because so the distribution at time 10 and time 11 almost the same, right? But here it must be very clear. What I said is the distribution will no longer change with time. It doesn't mean they don't make transitions, right? So it means that at time 10, the probability that you're in state 2 will be that number. You're in state 3 will be that number. At time 11, you're in state 2 will be this number. State 3 is in this number and so on. But you still make transitions. From time 10 to time 11, you still make transitions according to the transition probabilities, according to the transition matrix, right? You still make transitions, but the distribution no longer changes with time. So if so these two conditions hold, then we can say the Markov chain has reached a steady state. Steady state means the distribution no longer changes with time and become independent of the initial distribution. So the, and actually, for this steady state, so there's a corresponding notion for that, so which is called a limit distribution of a Markov chain. So let's think of a Markov chain that has a state space from 1 to m,
and suppose that it has a transition matrix P. And the distribution mu is said to be the limit distribution of the Markov chain if it's given by this. So let's see what is this. So we use so this is a distribution. Because this Markov chain has m states, so this is the distribution for those m states. So it's a mu 1 up to mu m. And of course, the sum of mu 1, mu 2 up to mu m should be equal to 1, because it is a distribution. And it must satisfy so these two conditions. So first, so it will not depend on your initial state. So no matter what your state, what is your initial state? Say if your initial state is I, so after k step, what is the transition probability from I to j? It will not depend on I. As k goes large, so this one should converge to something only depend on j, not on I, because initial state should not matter, right? So, and also, you should have, so this one, this should have a limit, which means that as k goes large, so it will not change with time. We'll have a limit. So as long as it satisfies, so these two conditions, again, so first, this does not all depend on your initial state or initial distribution. And second, it will no longer change with time. Then such a distribution is called a limit distribution. So at least from this example, you can see that in our laptop example, it does, the Markov chain does have a limit distribution, which is roughly given by this distribution vector. And also, so there's another notion closely related to limit distribution. It is called a stationary distribution. So let's see what is this stationary distribution. To motivate that, actually let's check. Let's think of what is the distribution of x11 in our laptop example. x11 should be the image level at the beginning of the 11th week, right? So suppose that we know the distribution of the 10th week, so which is given by this mu 10. And because from week 10 to week 11, we just need to make one position, right? So then we can think week 10 is our starting point. So in this way, so this the distribution of x11 should be equal to this mu 10 times p, right? And we just argue that actually mu 10 and mu 11 are roughly equal, because it should be one row of this matrix. It should be the same. If they're the same, if their mu 11 is roughly equal to mu 10, so then we should have this result. Mu 10 times p is equal to mu 10, right? What is mu 10? Mu 10 is, we know that this mu 10 should be very close to the limit distribution. So in other words, so the limit distribution should satisfy the property like this. The limit distribution times the transition matrix should be equal to itself, should be equal to the limit distribution. Based on this, so we introduce a notion called a stationary distribution. So what is a stationary distribution? We think of a Markov chain. So this Markov chain has a transition matrix P. If a probability distribution, so over the state space, so which is y pi 1 up to pi m, satisfies that pi times P is equal to pi, then this distribution pi is called a stationary distribution. So what is a stationary distribution? If pi as a row vector, as a distribution, times p
P is the transition matrix, is equal to itself, then pi is called a stationary distribution of the Markov chain. So what does it mean? So we can think of this stationary distribution in this way. So suppose, so this, the initial distribution of this Markov chain follows this pi. So this pi is the initial distribution at time zero. So then let's think of what is the distribution of this Markov chain at time one. From time zero to time one, how can we get the distribution? We just use this result, right? So initial distribution times transition matrix P should be the distribution at time one, right? If pi times P is equal to pi, if you start with pi, which means that after one step of transition, your distribution will keep the same, the same pi, right? You begin with pi. After one step, you're still in pi. Then you make the next transition, which is still governed by transition matrix P. Pi times P is equal to pi. So at time two, your distribution is still pi. So why is it called a stationary distribution? Because as long as you start with such a distribution, because pi times P is equal to pi, at any step, your distribution will always be pi. So that's why it is called stationary distribution. You begin with that, then the distribution, your distribution will be always like that. So but you see that this, the definition of stationary distribution is different from this definition of the limit distribution. Again, what is a limit distribution? Limit distribution says that, so this Markov chain evolves for amount of time. So if this time is sufficiently large, then this Markov chain, so the distribution of this Markov chain should be independent of the initial distribution or initial state, right? And also, so after some time, the distribution no longer changes with time. If it satisfies those two conditions, it is called a limit distribution. If this distribution satisfies pi times p is equal to pi, it's called stationary distribution. At least according to the definitions, those two are different, right? However, we just argue that the limit distribution must be a stationary distribution. Because the distribution needs to satisfy two conditions. First condition is that does not depend on your initial distribution. It's not, it will not change with time, right? As time goes large, it will not change. Because it will not change with time, it must satisfy this. It must be a stationary distribution. So then we can, we have this result. If a Markov chain has a limit distribution, then this limit distribution must be a stationary distribution. However, a stationary distribution may not be a limit distribution because certain Markov chains may have stationary distribution, but they may not have limit distribution. So again, if a Markov chain has a limit distribution, this limit distribution must be a stationary distribution. In other words, it must satisfy the equation pi times p equals to pi. However, certain Markov chains do not have a limit distribution, but they may have stationary distribution. Stationary distribution means if I begin with this distribution, then my distribution will not change with time. As long as I can find out a distribution satisfying this, then it's fine. But certain Markov chains may not have a limit distribution. So we will discuss that next time. But you need to know that the limit distribution must be a stationary distribution. So then, so let's think of, let's go back to check our example. So this laptop example, right? So far, if we wish to know how to calculate the distribution of x10, then what we need to do is to just use so the transition matrix P, transition matrix P, and to get the P to the power of 10, right? P to the power of 10, as I said, if you have a computer, if you have MATLAB or whatever software, then it's easy. But in the exam, say, I wish to let you find out the distribution of X10 in the exam, then if you wish to calculate the P to the power 10, I don't think it's easy, right? So then, but if we know that this P to the power 10 actually is very close to the limit distribution, then we may find other ways to calculate the distribution of X10. How can we do that? I think the strategy is like this. So first, as we argued here, so for this laptop example, we know that P to the power 10 will have identical entries in each row, right? And as a result, we know that, so for this 10-step position matrix, each row of it should be close to the limit distribution, right? So maybe we just think of that as the limit distribution. How to get this limit distribution? We know that limit distribution must be Schlitterbahn distribution, right? What is Schlitterbahn distribution? Schlitterbahn distribution is pi times p is equal to pi. It gives us a bunch of linear equations. We can try to solve these equations to get this pi. If these equations has a unique solution, so this unique solution, and as long as we know this Markov chain has a limit distribution, this unique distribution must also be the limit distribution. Right? So let me repeat that. For a Markov chain, suppose that it has a limit distribution. Because we know that the limit distribution must be a stationary distribution, right? So then we can solve this pi times p is equal to pi for this stationary distribution. If it happens that, so this set of linear equations has a unique solution, just one solution. Because we know the Markov chain has a limit distribution, and limit distribution must be the stationary distribution, this unique solution must be the limit distribution, right? And this limit distribution should be very, very close to the distribution of X10. So that's the idea. So then you see, how can we get this distribution of X10? So without using MATLAB, maybe you can just need to try to solve pi times p is equal to pi. Right? If it happens to have a unique distribution, because we know in our laptop example, the Markov chain has a limit distribution, that solution must be that limit distribution that can be used to approximate distribution of X10. So that's the idea. So then let's think of this guy. Pi times p is equal to pi. Actually, so this one has a name, is called balance equations. Pi times p is equal to pi is called balance equations. So if we consider the arbitrary Markov chain that has m states, so this pi should be a m-dimensional row vector. This P is a m by m square matrix. Pi times P is equal to pi. We should solve that. But it turns out that that's not sufficient. If we just rely on that, actually we may have infinitely many solutions. We must add one more solution, so which is pi 1, so which requires that this pi must be a distribution. So it means that the sum of pi 1 up to pi m must be equal to 1. So pi p times pi, pi times p is equal to pi, so this is called balance equations. And this one, the sum of pi is equal to 1, is called a normalization equation. So we must, if we wish to solve this, only if we solve them together, it's possible for us to find out the solution. But you can think of that. So pi has m entries, pi 1 up to pi m. And the p, as I said, is m by m. So pi times p is equal to pi. We have m equations there, right? And this normalization equation is an actual one. So if we put them together, we will have m plus 1 equations. But we have only m unknowns. So if you recall what you learned in linear algebra, if the number of equations is more than the number of unknowns, so what will happen? You either have no solution, or there will be redundant equations, right? And actually, in this case, so there is one redundant equation in pi p is equal to pi. There's only one redundant in the first m equations. So to solve this, you can arbitrarily remove one equation in the first m equations. Pi times p is equal to pi. You can remove arbitrarily one of them. But keep in mind, you can never remove this normalization equation. You must, when you solve for the station distribution, you must keep it. You cannot remove that. For the first m balance equations, you can remove one. Then, using the remaining m equations, it's possible for you to find out a unique solution. Okay? So that's the idea. And then maybe let's check how to find out the distribution of S10 by solving the stationary distribution. So here, so maybe we use we know that the state space is has three states, right? 2, 3, 4 for our laptop example. So we may just use the pi 2, pi 3, pi 4 for the stationary distribution for those three states, right? And we know that the transition matrix of this example looks like that. This is the transition matrix. And we wish to solve pi times p is equal to pi. So these are balance equations together with normalization equation. So the sum of them is equal to pi. So let's see how to solve that. So first, so we need to put down what is pi times p is equal to pi. So pi is this row vector, p is this one, right? So this row times this column, the first column, actually it's like this. Pi times the first column of p should be equal to the first entry of pi, which is pi 2, right? So this is the first equation. The second equation is this row times the second column, looks like that, right? Because the first one is zero, I just ignore that. So which should be equal to pi 3. And pi 4 should be equal to this row times the third column. So it should be this, the third one, the third equation. And we should also have this normalization equation, so which is here, right? As I said, the first three equations are balanced equations, and one of them is redundant. So we should remove the redundant one. So then the question is, which one is redundant? So you can arbitrarily remove one. So any one is fine. You can remove any one. So, but I would remove the so the one that looks most complicated, right? So this one looks more complicated to me than others, so I remove the third one. I remove the third one, so now I have three equations. So then I will try to solve these three equations for the stationary distribution. So let's see. Those three equations are looks like that, right? Here, again, so let me emphasize that again. Never remove the normalization equation. If you remove that, you will have infinitely many solutions, right? You must keep it. And then let's see how to solve the remaining three equations. So the second one looks the simplest. Maybe let's begin with the second one, right? Second one is a 0.3 pi 3 plus 0.3 pi 4 is equal to pi 3. You just, you know, so the move this 0.3 pi 3 to the right hand side, then we have a 0.3 pi 4 is equal to 0.7 pi 3. And from that, you can see pi 4 is equal to 7 over 3 pi 3. Right? And then we can plug in this result to the first one. To the first one, then this 0.3 pi 2 is this, 3 over 10 pi 2, plus, so 3 over 10 pi 3, plus 0.2 times pi 4. Because pi 4 is equal to 7 over 3 pi 3, so this one actually is equal to 7 over 15 pi 3. And from here, so we can move pi 2 to the right-hand side. Then the right-hand side should be 7 over 10 pi 2, right? The left-hand side should be, so this one plus this one. Actually, it's a... it's this number. It should be 23 over 30. And then from here, actually, you can find out that pi 2 is equal to 23 over 21 pi 3. So this is this one. And now we have used the first one, the second one. That now let's plug everything into the third one. So pi 2 is equal to 23 over 21 pi 3 plus pi 3 plus pi 4. Pi 4 is here. So then it should be equal to 1. And from that, we can have pi 3. And from pi 3, we can have pi 4. Pi 2, right? So then we got it. And then you see this pi should be equal to this. So this vector, it is the value of that. So this is how to solve the solve for the stationary distribution. And actually, if you check those fractions, it turns out that it is those numbers. So it's real close to U10. So that's the idea how to solve for
intent. And I think in the exam, it's possible that I give you a marker chain, maybe I give you a transition matrix, maybe a transition diagram, and so on. So for example, I may ask you, so if x0 is this, what is the probability that x10, x20, x50, x100, x200 is equal to whatever state, right? So in this way, I think there's no way for you to exactly calculate the, say, 100-step transition matrix. Then, in this way, how to calculate such a probability? You need a software. So this stationary distribution, right? So at least for the exam, it should be very clear how can we get this one. So the question is, would the result be the same if we remove the first equation? I think it would be the same, but if you don't believe that, you can try. So why is so? Because pi p is equal to pi, essentially it is equal to pi times I minus p is equal to zero. This I is identity matrix, right? Identity matrix, we know that the row sum of p is one. So the row sum of I minus p must be equal to zero. So which means that the column of I minus p must be linear dependent, right? Then as long as you can make remaining columns linearly independent, then the linear equation should have a unique solution, right? So you can remove the arbitrary one to make remaining columns to be linearly independent. So it should be fine. So this is the how to calculate this stationary distribution. And maybe we can talk a little bit more about balanced equations. So what is a balanced equation? It's pi times p is equal to pi, or pi is equal to pi times p, right? So if we think of an arbitrary one among those balanced equations, for example, so what is pi j? According to this, the balanced equations, pi j should be pi, so this row vector times the jth column of transition matrix, right? So it should be pi 1 times p1j up to pi m times pmj, right? So this is just one equation among the balanced equations. So let's see how to interpret this balanced equation. On the right-hand side is pi j. What is pi j? Just the probability that the Markov chain is in state j, right? But we know that, so the Markov chain must evolve indefinitely. So if you're in step j, then next step you must make transition. So in this way, this pi j can be understood as the probability make a transition from state j. Because from the upper state, you must make transition next step, right? That is the left-hand side. What is the right-hand side? The right-hand side, so for example, this is pi 1 times p1j. Pi 1 is the probability you're in state 1, right? Then you're in state 1, you need to make transition. So the probability that you make transition from 1 to j should be p1j, right? So then pi 1 times p1j is the probability that you're in state 1 and you make transition to state j. So in this way, so what is this pi m times pmj? you're in state M, and then we transition to J, right? So you see that on the right hand side, that is the probability that you make transition from an arbitrary state, from whatever state, into state J. On the left hand side, that's the probability that you make transition off of state J. On the right hand side, that's the probability that you make transition into state J. Why it is called balanced equation? It means that the probability that you make transition out of state is equal to the probability that you make transition into that state. So then you see you reach a balance about the input and output. So as a result, the distribution will not change. But as I said, the distribution cannot change. It doesn't mean that you no longer make transitions. You still make transitions. But because of this balance equation, so as long as I satisfy this, the distribution will not change, right? So that's why we call it balance equation. But we may think of this. Balance equation says that the probability that you make transition into a state is equal to the probability that you're out of a state. So in a steady state, actually, the probability, maybe we can think of a bunch of states rather than individual states, right? If we consider a set of states, then if the Markov chain is in the steady state, according to this balance equation, the probability into a set of states should be equal to the probability out of the same set of states, right? Because for each one, for each state, you reach a balance. If we consider a set of states, you should still have the balance, right? So then I'm asking the question, what better to think of this? Because sometimes, so this very simple observation or a very simple idea may help you to simplify a calculation. So for example, if we think of a Markov chain like this, so this Markov chain has four states, 0 to 3. And you see, so the transition probabilities are given by this transition diagram. And this Markov chain, so this transition diagram looks a bit, you know, it looks very nice. I mean, it looks like a chain, right? So for each state, it can only make transitions to adjacent state, right? So why it looks like chain? Because you can only make transition to an adjacent state. In this way, for such a chain, actually, so such a chain is a corresponds to the so-called Bierstadt process. For such a chain, we have a simpler way to calculate its station distribution. So let's see how to do that. So we know that for this Markov chain, it has four states. So, for example, we may make a cut here. So this cut will divide the state space into two parts. The first part has only one state, which is state 0. The second part has three states, which are 1, 2, 3, right? So in a steady state, because we need to reach a balance, the probability into that part should be equal to the probability that out of that part, right? The probability into that part, so which means the probability from, so this part from the right-hand side into the left-hand side should be equal to pi 1 times 2/3. That is the probability into that part. The probability out of that part should be pi 0 times 1/3, right? So it looks like that. That's the transition equation for the first cut. Then imagine that we remove the first cut, and then we cut the state space here. So this cut divides the state space into two parts. The first part is 0 and 1, the second part is 2 and 3.
right? And in steady state, the transition probability into the part on the left-hand side should be pi 2 times 2/3. Out of that part should be 1/3 times pi 1. They should be equal, right? So this one. And we can remove this cut, and this time we make a cut here. We make a cut here, then the first part is 0, 1, 2, the second part is 3, right? The transition into the part on the left-hand side should be pi 3 times 1. Out of that part should be 1/3 times pi 2. They should be equal. So that is the third one, right? And then, so we have three equations supporting these three cuts. And because for each cut, we include a new state, so then those three equations must be linearly independent. And then because we have totally four states, we need to have four equations. So then the fourth one should be the normalization equation. So then we have so these equations, four equations. So let's see how to solve them. So this is what we have, right? So for example, according to the first one, so we can see pi 0 must be equal to 2 pi 1, right? And according to the second one, pi 1 must be equal to 2 pi 2. According to the third one, pi 2 should be equal to 3 pi 3, right? So as I said, we just make a cut here, cut here, cut here, because only one way in, one way out. So those equations looks pretty simple. And then from the third one, we can recover each pi. Pi 2 is equal to 3 pi 3, and pi 1 is equal to 2 pi 2, which is equal to 6 pi 3, and the pi 0 is equal to 2 pi 1, should be equal to 12 pi 3, right? And then according to the normalization equation, so we just put those guys together, then we can see pi 3 should be equal to 1 over 22. And we can recover pi 2, pi 1, pi 0, according to here, and then we have this pi, right? You see in this way, it can help you to simplify the calculation a little bit. So that's how to use this idea to simplify the calculation a little bit. Questions? So if no questions, I think we can stop here and see you next week.